Our next presentation comes from Amaury Sechet. He is a software engineer at Facebook, LLVM committer, and the main developer of the decompiler SDC. He learned about Bitcoin in 2010 and got involved as early as 2011, but mostly quietly. Seeing Bitcoin failing to scale, he decided to take matters into his own hands and decided to apply his experience of large-scale systems to Bitcoin. His presentation is titled A Journey to the Moon, Bitcoin as a World Currency.
All right, so I wanted to bring you to a journey to the moon. I got into the Bitcoin world in 2011. Before that, I learned about it in about 2010, but didn't get involved right away. Got involved into it in 2011. And at the time, everybody was going for the moon. And by that, I mean, everybody was envisioning Bitcoin as a world currency. Bitcoin would serve the unbanked, revolutionize fintech, and shift the power. And it was all great and good, but I decided to get much more involved and take a much active role in 2016 because it seems that we have some trouble getting to the moon, and maybe I can help. So at the time, we had like a bunch of things going on. Maybe people that are newcomer, they don't know about it, but we used to have that guy on the various forum that was called To The Moon Guy, and that was posting all kind of smileys when the price was going up. Everybody was seeing Bitcoin as a world currency, so mandatory Satoshi quote, where it basically says that Bitcoin can scale to Visa level and maybe even more. Reed Favinge from the Pirate Party, that same stuff, like see Bitcoin as being adopted around the world and see it gaining a huge value because you need each Bitcoin to have a use value to, you know, adapt to this kind of market. There was a bunch of meme going on, and basically the main idea is that we're going to the moon. Even better, maybe, a lot of people think that it would definitively change the power dynamic in the world because people who control the money today wouldn't have as much power as they are right now, and maybe dramatically reduce or make it much more difficult to have war, right? Like the kind of large-scale war we have today. So this is the spirit of the time. I think it's best summed up by Discover of Bitcoin magazine from 2013, where, you know, we are going to the moon, this is happening, and like we are on the way, basically. But today it's a bit more difficult, I'd say. A lot of people that are leader in the Bitcoin development thinks that it is not possible and it is not desirable. Maybe some of them think that Bitcoin is already too large today, and that is a problem, right? Because if you put people in charge that don't believe it is possible, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. At the end, it's not gonna be possible. So this is pretty much what it looks like right now. We were taking off for the moon, but you know, something happened in the way, and we are not aiming for the moon anymore. So the vision has been lost. The leader don't think it's possible or even desirable to pursue that vision. There is no scaling happening. There is a ton of censorship going on. Because of that, newcomers, they tend to not being exposed to that vision at all. They live in the echo chamber and they don't even know about it because it's been going on for a long time now. And we used to make fun of the Bitcoin. So at the time, there was this professor that said that in 2014, the price of Bitcoin would be below $10. And Bitcoiner made a website and made fun of this guy. And there was a counter for his prediction, and obviously it did not come true. But at the time, we used to make fun of those people that don't believe in Bitcoin, and now we put them in charge, and that's quite troubling. Everybody lost sight of the moon. So the scaling debate, there was this scaling debate on, like, should we have bigger blocks? Should we support more usage and more users? And it went pretty much as follows. Like, the initial proposal was 20 megabyte block, and it was no, and 8, and 248. And every time it was not possible, it was too big, it was too big of a risk. And at the end, there was this Hong Kong agreement that was made, where we would have 2 megabyte blocks in addition to a technology called Sechet. And as it turned out today, there is no 2 megabyte block inside, and people want to activate Sechet. So it seems like there have been no compromise that have been done. And it's kind of sad, because when people don't want to compromise, then conflict become unavoidable. So this is the state of affair right now. I want to be here to journey to the moon, because I think people that don't share the vision and don't believe into that this is possible shouldn't get in the way of people who are actually doing it. And also, I would like the community to understand that most of these people, they are cryptographers, and that's well and good, but cryptography and large-scale system expert are two different fields of expertise, and it would actually be unfair to expect from cryptographer to be able to set up large-scale system and have them to work. Just as the opposite would be true, right? So my experience is more on the large-scale system side of things. And if you would ask me to do cryptography, I could do it to some extent, but like really, you probably shouldn't ask me. That'd be a bad idea. So I'm here to, you know, tell everybody we can reach the moon and we should try. So if we want to reach the moon, like the first question we want to ask ourselves is, where's the moon anyway? So if we assume there is about 500 byte per transaction, this is a bit, transaction typically are gonna, you know, be 300 to 500 bytes. So this is like a bit on the high end, but we want a rough estimate here. We don't want an exact number. We want to have an idea of how big this thing is. We assume 10,000 transactions per second. This is the kind of volume that Visa is doing. And that would mean we want to have 6 million transactions per block on average. And this is great. This is great because if we have this kind of volume, we can have very low fee per transaction and maintain the current level of security. We can have 0.1, literally 0.1 cent per transaction and have about the same level of security we have right now. And maybe, you know, with 1 cent per transaction on average, we can have significantly higher security. So that's cheap and that's secure. But that means about 3 gigabyte per block. And if we want to include also the unbanked, today, a bit more than half of the world population doesn't have access to any kind of banking services. If we want to include those people, then that would be about 8 gigabyte per block on average. But this is an average, and there is a fair amount of variance in the block production. And because of this, we need to be ready to absorb up to 50 gigabyte blocks, which is significantly bigger to what we are right now. But that's not the end of it, because what I just did would be kind of trying to size the internet by looking how many fax people are sending and how many letters people are sending. And then you assume, like, what if everybody sends fax and letter using the internet instead of doing what they are doing right now? How big the internet would need to be? But as it turned out, the internet is much bigger than that, because it enabled people to do a lot of stuff that they just couldn't do before. And there is a ton of new usage that didn't exist before that have been enabled by the internet. And in a world where Bitcoin is very successful, then I think we should assume that there are going to be usage that we don't know about right now. To give you a small anecdote, at the time where the IP protocol that powers internet was discussed, there was tens of computers on the internet, and there was a big debate about should the addresses be 2 bytes or 4 bytes. So 2 byte addresses would allow to connect about 65,000 people on the internet. And this is already several orders of magnitude more than there are computers on the internet at the time. And 4 byte addresses would allow to connect 4 billion machines. And at the time, 2 bytes is a very big amount of data. It's significant. If you have to send 2 bytes for the addresses, meaning 4 additional bytes per message in every IP packet, then that's the big deal for the kind of processing power people have at the time. So a lot of people think that having addresses to connect 4 billion people is crazy, and 65,000 people is already several orders of magnitude more than what they need, so they should do that. And as it turned out, today we are running out of those addresses. We have close to 4 billion devices connected to the internet, probably more if we count that. And well, we need IPv6, right? And this is a big problem. This is very complicated to upgrade. So we definitively want a size for those 8 gigabyte blocks and up to 50 gigabytes due to variance, but we need to be ready for much more if that was to come. And if you share my vision, you should hope that this is coming. Paul Krugman said that by 2005, it would be clear that the internet would have no more impact than the fax machine. And what I'm trying to say here is, like, don't be Paul Krugman. There are going to be new usage patterns that emerge that are enabled by the technology, and we want to support those. So, what do we scale this giant fax machine that sends transactions? If we have 8 gigabyte blocks on average, we're generating 9 terabyte of blockchain a day and about 3.2 petabyte of blockchain a year. And we have a big problem. That's a huge amount of data. We cannot operate at this kind of scale doing it naively like we do it today. But before I get into the solution, I wanted to make clear we agree on some definition, because I see those words used almost interchangeably, and I absolutely need to make it clear, otherwise none of what I'm going to say is going to make any sense. So the first one I want to talk about is performance, and performance is how fast a system can process a given workload. So it doesn't care about the amount of resources it uses to do so. For instance, if you add a new CPU in your server that is faster than the old one, you have increased the performance of your server. Obviously, you haven't increased its efficiency. So its efficiency is how much resources compared to how much workload can be processed compared to how much resources it uses. So if you put a more powerful CPU in your server, you've increased performance, you haven't increased efficiency, you just have put more CPU resources on the same workload. However, if you use a smarter algorithm, for instance, then you've increased efficiency. An example I would take would be, you program a video games and you need to render a frame every 16 milliseconds because, it's so fast, you need to run the frame for your video game to be fast and reactive. Then if you have some algorithm that take 20 milliseconds to run, you don't meet the kind of performance you need for this video game. But if you spread the workload of this algorithm into 2 cores on the machine, and now each core is gonna run for 12 milliseconds, then you've increased performances because now you can run the algorithm in 12 milliseconds, but you haven't increased efficiency. Actually, you've made your system less efficient, right? Because now you have 2 cores that run for 12 milliseconds, so you use 24 milliseconds of CPU time instead of just 20. So this is an example where you increase performance, you decrease efficiency. On the other hand, if you change the algorithm, you choose a smarter algorithm, that maybe is going to run in 12 milliseconds, but still on one core, then you've increased both performance and efficiency. Now I want to talk about capacity. Capacity is how big of a workload your system can take. And there is two kind of capacity we're interested in. The first one is the capacity you can deliver to users. So you look at what is the usage pattern of my users and how many user having this given usage pattern I can serve. This is the capacity you want to consider when you want to consider what kind of value you want to deliver to your user. And there is the worst case scenario, like what if all my user are doing something horrible that use a lot of resources on my side? What kind of capacity do I have here? An example I would take is if people search for Bitcoin into Google, this is a word that is searched into Google a lot. So if you search for Bitcoin into Google, then there is probably the result is pre-computed somewhere and Google is just gonna pull this result from its cache and serve you the result. However, if you look for something very uncommon into Google, then your request go to some database that need to, you know, do the matching of whatever website you think is appropriate, do some ranking and give you the best results. So this kind of request is much more expensive for Google to run. So what if everybody start to do this kind of request? What kind of capacity Google has? And finally, scaling. Scaling is not capacity. Scaling is how much, if you want to increase your workload, how much extra resources do you need? So how much the resources vary depending on how the workload varies. And specifically for scaling, you are especially interested in the worst case scenario, not the average one. So when you look at the product perspective and how much value you deliver to user, you want to look at your average scenario, the typical usage pattern for user. But when you look at capacity planning and scaling, you want to look at the worst case scenario because you don't want user to use the system differently from what you plan to bring it down. So some example to make that clear. There is a leap SSCP 256K1. This is a leap that do elliptical cryptography that have been made for Bitcoin. It makes signature much more efficient to check, much more performant as well. Signature has about 3 times faster to check with that library. So this improves performance and efficiency, but doesn't improve scaling or capacity. Compact block and heatsink improve performance and efficiency as well by decreasing the amount of work that need to be done to transmit the block over the network. But it doesn't change scaling, right? Like there is still that much data that need to be transmitted and it may change a bit capacity, but not that much. Like it's especially a performance and efficiency improvement. If we change the block size, then we improve capacity definitively because we can put more transaction in the blockchain, but we haven't actually increased scaling, right? Like if we want two times the block size, then we need 2 times as much resources to process them. If we put 4 times the block size, we need 4 times as much resources. So the scaling characteristic of the change, we just improve capacity, not scaling. And then Sechet, which is a technology that does a lot of different things. It improved performance and efficiency of signature checking by fixing quadratic checking, hashing. It improved capacity by creating an extension block and putting the signature in there. However, it decreased scaling because the value delivered to user, depending on different estimates, is going to be from 1.7 to about 2 megabytes. But the worst case scenario is actually a 4 megabyte block. So the system need to be absorbed. Need to be ready to absorb up to a 4 megabyte block, but only delivers 1.7 to 2 megabyte of value to users. So that actually like decreased scaling. So scaling is about big O. For people that are not familiar with big O, is how you, the amount of work you need to do to process some workload varies depending on the size of the workload. So if it's O of one, basically constant time, it means that the work you need to do doesn't depend on the size of the workload. Log N means that if the workload becomes twice as big, you add one unit of work. And then twice as big again, one more unit of work. So if we have one item to process, we need one unit of work. If we have two items to process, we need two units of work. But then we can process up to four items with three units of work. And then eight items with four units of work. Anyway, this is very scalable. You can get to very huge workload without doing too much work. Then you have O of N, which is called also linear scaling, which means that if the workload becomes twice as big, then you have twice as much work to do. And log N, you can still scale to some extent, which is basically you have a log N operation to do N time, right? So this is like the multiplication between the two. Everything bigger than that is not gonna scale. You can see like the on the curve very quickly, they go vertical very, very, very fast. So if the workload gets big, those kind of algorithm cannot be used anymore. So quick summary, I'll just say, if it's less than linear, then this is fine. If it's linear, we probably need to shard if n's get very big. If it's n log n, we definitely need to shard. If it's more than that, forget about it. This won't scale. Sharding is just spreading the workload on several machines. It's also called horizontal scaling sometimes. So let's take an example of quadratic caching. So I don't think quadratic caching is a major scaling issue because it scales with the size of transaction and not the amount of transaction we want to go through. So it's only a problem if we want to start to do 1 megabyte, maybe 10 megabyte transactions. But I don't think this is where most of the demand is. Still worth something. So what's the problem is? The problem is you need to hash the transaction for each signature operation. And the more signature operation you have in your transaction, and the bigger the transaction becomes. So you need to hash more and more byte, more and more time. Because of this, you have quadratic hashing, so n squared. This doesn't scale, so you cannot have very big transaction with very many CGOPS. BIP143 create a new async scheme that don't have this problem. It's implemented by both SegWit and flexible transaction. Specifically in SegWit, however, when it comes to scaling, this is not a scaling solution because SegWit being a soft fork, you still have the old transaction. So the average case scenario becomes better. So that's a nice optimization that improves performance and efficiency. But you still have the same worst case scenario that is this quadratic hashing. So you actually haven't improved scaling there. But if you would do it as a hard fork, you could improve scaling there. Let's talk a bit about proof of work. And then everything is gonna tie together. Proof of work essentially has three roles today. It makes it expensive to rewrite history. It creates align economic incentive. So what it means, like the people having hash rate are gonna be more profitable by doing the right thing than by doing the wrong thing. And because of that, they are de-incentivized to act against the network best interest. And it ensures eventual consistency. So this is the part I'm the most interested in. What is eventual consistency? Well, Bitcoin is a distributed system. And that means that information takes time to propagate between nodes. And so at any given time, some nodes are going to be aware of some information and some other nodes are going to be not aware of this information. And vice versa, right? Like the information comes from everywhere and takes time to spread over the network, which means that every node at any given time do not agree on what the state of the world is. And so we say that the state in the system is inconsistent. And this is a node problem. You can actually mathematically prove that this is not solvable like 100%. But you can solve it well enough by doing what we call eventual consistency. And eventual consistency is you have algorithms that ensure that, you know, over time the network converges toward a common understanding of what the state of the world is. And in Bitcoin right now, this only works if the block time is far greater than the block propagation, like the time the block needs to propagate on the network. So that's easy to explain, right? Like if we assume that the blue area in this graph is, you know, the node processing and waiting for a block to be found, and the green area is a block propagating, the time a block needs to propagate on the network. Well, during this green area, a second block can be found. And if the green area is 10% of the green plus blue area, then there is 10% of chance that a block is found while a previous block is propagating. So you have 10% chance. And then you have the network split in half. Half of it is going to build on top of one block. Half of it is going to build on top of the other block. And you again have a 10% chance that the next block in those two chain are going to be found at the same time. So now you have like 10% of 10%. So you have a 1% chance that there is two block, like the fork goes two block deep. And then you have 0.1% chance that is three block deep and so on. So as long as the green area is small compared to the blue area, the probability of this going on over time decreases exponentially. So we know we are going to reach eventually a consistent state. However, if the green area becomes too big, then the probability that each block found is going to fork the network becomes big. And then you may end up in a situation where the network starts forking faster than it can reconcile those forks, and you'd never reach stability. So the problem is that the bigger the block, the longer they need to propagate. And so the block size is a gating factor in, you know, how big this green area is. And so there is a gating factor here on how big we can scale before the network becomes unstable. So the workload of the node is like, I'm receiving transaction, but I'm not doing much. And I receive a block, I need to work like crazy to validate it as fast as possible and move it around as fast as possible to keep this characteristic that allows the network to converge. The situation we want to find ourselves in is the node cooperates to build the block over time. And when a block is found by a miner, every node is like, yeah, this is pretty much what I expected. I can stem that, move it around. I don't have a lot of work to do. And if we do that way, then most of the workload is shifted in the blue area, and there is much less work to do in the green area. So the green area can be kept small even if block gets big. So basically we want to move the eventual consistency algorithm, we want to move away from proof of work for that specific one and do it over time and keep proof of work for security. So the first step we want to take to go in that direction is mempool synchronization. Mempool synchronization is, so the mempool is all the transactions a node is aware of that are not validated yet. So you can make sure that if the nodes have very consistent mempool across the network, then you know that they know about the same transaction. And when you transmit the block, you can say, okay, here is the transaction that are in the block. I don't transmit you the transaction again. You already have them, you already validate them. So that is that less work to do to propagate the block, and you can reach bigger block to that with that. So Xin and compact block actually use that to some extent to speed up block propagation, but we can do better. And we can do better by having nodes continuously keep track of each other mempool. They can do that by exchanging Bloom filter on a regular basis. If you send only the update on the Bloom filter, there is very few elements that have been added to the Bloom filter. So let's say I'm node A, I send my Bloom filter to node B, and then I wait a little, I receive a few transactions, and I send an update to node B. Now in my update, I only need to add the extra few transactions I just received. And that's it, right? So there is very little in my Bloom filter update that I need to send. And so I can use compression technique to make that very compact. This kind of technique is used in video game, and I wrote an article about it that you will be able to click on when I share the slide after this is presented. So this uses Bloom filter that is probabilistic data structure that represents a set of whatever, in our case, a set of transaction. And this is very compact because it's probabilistic. If the Bloom filter says something is not in the set, then it's definitively not in the set. But sometimes the Bloom filter say, yes, this is in the set when it actually isn't. If things are done right, this happens very, very infrequently. And by allowing that to happen very, very infrequently, we can have tremendous win efficiency. So that's a very good data structure to use for this kind of work. So this impact Xin, because Xin actually use a Bloom filter when sending a block. But you could remove this step where the Bloom filter is exchanged to be ahead of time and just do the second part of Xin, where you send the block, but you don't send the Bloom filter. Right, the second problem you want to solve is transaction ordering, because if all nodes agree on the set of transactions they see, they still can't build a block with that because they don't know in what order the transactions are. And if you have a set of n transactions, there is n factorial different ordering they can have. That means that you need at least n log n bit to spread that around. So this is not scaling the way we want it. However, we know that transactions form a data acyclic graph because of the characteristic of the hash function we use to build the transaction. We cannot create the loop in there. If you want to create the loop in there, you're going to have to break the hash function. So if we consider that malleability is fixed, we can use transaction ID to order transaction instead of ordering them in chronological order. Because of that, then we have a canonical order, and if nodes can agree on the set of transactions, they can build the same block. To do so, we can use Merkle's tree that I'm going to explain more in detail later. Because transactions are ordered, you can also reduce the entropy and transmit block faster. So the shove techniques here is subchain. It's been proposed by Peter Risen. And the idea is that miner can publish blocks they're working on with a lower PoE requirement than the actual block. And because of that, they can produce more of those and they can announce to the network what they are working on. And they get obviously no reward to do that, except that now the network is aware of what they're working on and the network is ready to validate that, so they reduce their orphan risk. So there is an incentive for them to play nice. You can create a DAG of subblock into subchains, and then every new subblock or actual block, you can say, here is the tip of the subchain I'm building upon, here is the few transactions I added on top of that, and so this is my block and I have proof of work. So now the block propagation time doesn't depend on the size of the block, but depends only on the amount of transactions that have been added since the last subchain block that is built upon. So you can get significantly bigger blocks once again while keeping the network running efficiently. So that means that block can be built over time, block can be built over time. When PoE takes longer due to variance, this is, I think, a very, very important point that is often overlooked. The block every 10 minutes is an average, but a few times a year, it can take up to an hour. So we want to be in a situation where we build the block ahead of time, right? So now we have an hour block, that contains an hour worth of transactions. So it's much bigger than the average block. It can be, if we look at my number earlier, up to 50 gigabytes. But we also have an hour to build it. So, you know, at the end, it's not harder to propagate over the network. So it's a very good way to absorb the variance that is due to the way pool works. And miner have a strong incentive to play nice, because if they don't, they increase their offline risk, right? If you don't share what you're working on, you suddenly are trying to propagate 8 gigabytes of data on the network that nobody is aware of. It's gonna take a very long time. And during that time, another miner is gonna undercut you if it plays nice with the system. So there is an incentive for miner to play nice here. Wrap up. We don't use PoE for event trail consistency anymore, only for security. Event trail consistency is reached continuously over time during the time the block is constructed. That means that zero-conf transaction now becomes much more secure than it used to, and it enables a new use case on the network. And it also means that node resources can be used more efficiently, because right now, block propagation needs to be short compared to the rest of the time, which means like block work, nodes work 100% during this block propagation time and work not use their resources efficiently the rest of the time. If we build a block over time, we can use the node resources efficiently all the time. So it's a much more efficient system, which means it's cheaper to run at any given scale. So that also means you have a problem to bootstrap node, because now if node are used 90% of resources all the time, you only have 10% of extra resources to catch up for a node that is late. That means that if a node is 1 year late, it needs 10 years to catch up with the system. So that's a very big problem. So what do we do for that? We use UTXO commitment. So UTXO commitment, you essentially create a second Merkle tree of not the transaction that are in the block, but the whole UTXO set at this point in time. And nodes can verify that this UTXO set commitment is valid. And because of that, a new node can, you know, download an updated UTXO set at any time and start validating right away. And then use this 10% extra resources the node have to validate backward up to the point it's gone back in time backward long enough so it, you know, it knows, it's confident enough that the chain it's working on is actually a legitimate chain. It works well in practice. You know, like cryptographer like to secure everything mathematically. And to do so, you would have to validate everything up to the genesis block. But in practice, if you rewind the blockchain by a year, especially if you have a world scale currency, everybody's gonna notice, right? And so this is not that much of an event you should be afraid of. You should never be afraid of this be done on short period of time. So you definitely need to go backward in time. But you want to be backward, you know, like far enough so you are confident that the blockchain you're working on is legit and you don't need to go back up to the genesis block if you don't want to. So, how far away is the moon? We already have a lot of stuff. Are we there yet? Not quite, but we're getting there. The last thing that is missing for us is going to be sharding. So as the workload gets bigger, there is only so big that one single server can be. Let's consider our UTXO set. We'd say that we want to grow the size of the network by 4 orders of magnitude. That means that the UTXO set for in this kind of scenario would be around 10 terabytes. That is huge. And that's probably not the kind of stuff that one user on one machine want to process. And if we imagine, you know, much bigger success, then we have maybe hundreds of terabytes UTXO set and maybe even bigger. And you don't want to have like just one machine to process all this data. It's gonna be horribly inefficient. So you need a way to spread the workload. In most systems, this is fairly easy to do because not trust each other. So if you are Google, you have a bunch of servers working to solve a request, but those servers, they trust each other. So if one of the servers say to another server, hey, here is my result, then the other server can trust that this is legit because all the servers are operated by Google and Google trusts itself. But in the case of Bitcoin, do not trust each other. That means that they need cryptographic proof when they are exchanging information that those information are correct. So it works out if you do it that way because blocks are very expensive to produce, but if the proof is both compact, easy to check, and cheap enough to produce, maybe not as cheap as to check, but cheap enough to produce, you know that the economic of producing an invalid block does not check out because it's going to be much cheaper for someone else to prove that your block is wrong than for yourself to produce this wrong block. So with compact cryptographic proof, we can make that work. So there is a first very obvious division that is going to happen in the network. It's fairly evident, I think, for technical people, but for less technical people, you can think of it as division of labor. There is different kind of work that need to be done, and there is different kind of machines that are going to be more suited to do that work. So it's just like economic specialization, if you want to see it that way. I see a very obvious split between UTXO nodes, so that's not that managed UTXO set. They are going to need large storage, and they are going to do a lot of input-output operation. Basically, they have a workload that very much look like the one of a database. And you have relay nodes. So those are validating transaction and transaction signature and moving the transaction around and providing services for SPV clients. So those nodes don't have as much storage requirement, but they have very, very high CPU-intensive workload. So you would want different type of server to run these two different types of workload. To do so, I'm gonna present quickly a data structure that can be used to achieve those goals, which is the Merkle tree. So I kind of hinted at it before, so it's the time to explain now. It's basically a radix tree and you Merkleized it. So Merkleized it, that means that you hash every node and at every node you associate the hash of its children. And because of that, you can have a root hash of the tree, and you can prove any branch of the tree is there or is not there from the root hash. And you cannot really fake the root hash because it's required to break the hash function, which is cryptographically secure. So the Merkle tree allows you to store key value pair. In the case of transaction, you would have the key be the transaction ID and the value of the transaction itself. In the case of UTXO, you want the key to be the transaction ID as well, but the value to be the unsped output. And because it's a radix tree, you can share data by prefix. So all the data that have a common prefix, they're going to be in the same part of the tree. So you can have one node that processes this part of the tree and one other node that processes another part of the tree. And the key being a hash, cryptographic hash, the workload is going to be well spread out over the whole tree. You won't end up with a tree that is very unbalanced. So this is all that work to prove that something is in the tree. Here we want to prove that item one is in the tree. So we provide item one and its hash. And then we provide the yellow item. So if you hash 3738 with 6 EEC, you find BF1B, which is this node. And then you hash that with D9FE, and you can verify that you end up to the root of the tree. So item one, you actually like prove cryptographically that item one is in the tree. On the other hand, you can prove that something is not in the tree. So we see here that BF1B is a node of all items that start with a zero. But D9FE is a node that have all the items starting with 111. This is the common prefix of all the items that are in those two trees. So if you want to prove that there is no item in the tree that starts with 110, you can provide those two nodes. And you can know that this item starting with 110 doesn't start by zero and doesn't start with 111. So it's not in any of those subtree, and you can prove that there is nothing in between those two subtrees. So effectively, you prove that any item started by 110 is not in the tree. So using this data structure, you can both shard and both produce proof that something is or is not in the tree, and you can use that. So if you use that for UTXO commitment, we have a huge tree with all UTXO commitment. The UTXO node can serve requests for other nodes, and they cannot lie because they can prove to you, okay, this input is in the set or this input is not in the set, and I can prove it to you cryptographically. Additionally, you can reduce the workload on UTXO node quite a lot, because once the proof is produced, there is no request, no extra request to the UTXO set that needs to be done. The relay node can pass the proof to one another and be happy with that. So that reduces the UTXO load quite a lot. You can also aggregate the amount in each node, the amount that isn't spent in this subtree. And because of that, you can ensure that the overall money supply is, you know, is kept constant and is not faked. And your monetary system is sound. It's very easy to for UTXO node to prove that the UTXO set is not reliable. So to do so, so this UTXO set would be unreliable if a spent output was not removed from the UTXO set, so that would allow someone to spend it twice later and creates money in the process. A new output was created out of thin air. So I'm a UTXO node and I assert input for myself or my friend into the UTXO set so they can spend it. Or maybe someone created a transaction to spend some UTXO and it's created new UTXO, and I don't add this new UTXO, so I'm destroying someone's money. Each of these scenarios is actually fairly easy to prove for the UTXO node, and they can broadcast a proof on the network. And because the proof is cheap to produce and cheap to check, if we assume that there is just one node that is honest, then we know that we can trust this UTXO commitment. So the economics checks out. So using that, we can have a reliable route. It's useful as well, even for people that have a set of nodes. They want to spread the workload on those nodes, but they trust each other because maybe they're in the same situation as Google, right? They control all the servers, so the servers know they can trust each other. It's still useful for them because it provides the data structure that's going to shut the workload naturally. So large trust entity, I assume, you know, a company like Coinbase are going to verify everything, or miner, they're going to verify everything as well. But it helped them because it allowed them to spread the workload easily. And smaller user or smaller entity can set up node that verify a part of the network. And because it's cheap to do so, there can be many of them that verify many different parts of the network. So it becomes, so we avoid the situation when only some big entities can validate the whole blockchain. And by taking control of this entity, you take control of the network. Because of this, you can have a ton of small users that are very much decentralized that validate each of them part of a subset of the whole workload. And you do just fine. You need to have the number, as a side note, you need to have this number of node and of user scaling with the square root of the size of the network. So if the network gets 100 times bigger, you just need 10 times more people running node to keep the same level of security and decentralization. All right, so we can do the same by sharding the block validation if that becomes necessary. If you use a Merkle tree in the block itself for the transaction, then we can have relay node that only process a subset of the block. And the thing you want to check here is that the blocks contain only valid transactions, so you want to check the signature there. The transaction don't spend more money than, like, you know, don't create money, basically. The amount that is in the input should be larger or equal than the amount that is in the output. And that the transaction actually spend money that exists and that is valid and that they can spend. And finally, they want to check that the minor reward that is in the count base do match the transaction fee that are in the block. So the last three constraints are actually very similar to the kind of constraints you have in the UTXO set, and you can prove them pretty much the same way. The count base is a bit more tricky because this is a constraint over the whole block. However, you can aggregate fees, just like we aggregate amount on the UTXO set, you can aggregate fees of transaction in the node of the block, and then you can prove at any point that the fee are not added correctly, and at the top you have the, you know, the transaction fee that the miner should receive, and everybody can agree on that number. So that works as well. All the invalidity condition can be provided by right-click's proof. There is a very important side effect to that, is that SPV wallet are in that system are just like a full node that checks zero shard. And that means that the security of SPV node is increased dramatically. And obviously we can share the workload to get to absurdly large scale. So that's what we wanted. That was our main goal here. So let's wrap this up. I hope I convinced you that scaling to very large scale is possible, that solution exists, and they are realistic. So now we've discussed technical things a lot. I want to try to revive the dream for you guys. Like, are we going to the moon or not? Like, we wanted to go to the moon, and we cannot lose sight of the moon because of all the bickering for those 2 megabyte block or SegWit or whatever. However, even like 2 megabyte block, like none of these bring us to the moon, right? And we want to go to the moon. This is where we're gonna go. So please look at the moon. Join me, because I want to go there, and I cannot go there alone. So I want you guys to join me, and I want us together to go to the moon. Quick wrap up. Revive the dream. We're going to the moon. Don't be Paul Krugman. This is very bad for your brain. Don't be Paul Krugman. We get a lot of nice side effects from scaling that, you know, fall due to that algorithm, meaning zero-conf become much, much more secure. And zero-conf enable a ton of use cases that right now are not that great. So if we could stop spending time on RPF bullshit or whatever and just scale and make zero-conf secure, that'd be super great. That'd be very valuable for Bitcoin. Horizontal scaling made SPV much more secure because it enabled proofs and fraud proofs. And this is also a great win for everybody in Bitcoin. So we want to definitively go there. The moon is definitely waiting for us. We can get there. We can probably go even beyond, because there is a ton of use cases we haven't thought of yet. So if all goes well, we can reach Mars. So get your ass to Mars. So the question is, for UTXO sharding, would it work in a way, for an example, so say, such as an individual order of coin could store the merge clicks path to prove the coin exists when they want to spend them? The path is going to change depending on other UTXO. So for an individual to do that, this individual would have to keep track that the UTXO that share a common path with its own UTXO, but it's definitively possible. When they want to spend the coin, they would then provide this data to the network. They could also pay UTXO node to keep data for them. This would align the burden of storing UTXO data with those who benefit from it. Yeah, I think this is one of the benefits here. With that system, not all the nodes need to know all the UTXO. They can prove to each other that some UTXO is valid, and that reduces the workload that exists on the UTXO. Yeah. Okay, so Alex is saying some people say they need to have the complete blockchain, or otherwise they have to trust someone. What do you think about this? So I'm gonna answer that. None of what I presented prevent you to hold the whole blockchain if you want to. However, it's gonna be expensive to do so if the blockchain gets really big, right? And the most interesting part of that is at the end is the UTXO set, right? Like everything else is just historical data on how you got there. None of this historical data could be changed without very important proof of work and without changing all the hashes along the way. So it's true that mathematically you gotta trust someone if you don't wanna go back to the Genesis block. But in practice, if someone starts to rewrite 1 year of blockchain or something like that, everybody's gonna notice it, right? Because all the hashes of all the blocks are gonna change. All node operators are gonna see a huge rollback of many, many transactions and a huge buildup of new ones. And when it gets to human scale like this, I think a human response to this kind of event would be more appropriate than a algorithmic one. So my point is, yeah, you need to trust someone, but right now you can have historical hashes of blocks everywhere. There is many blockchain explorer. You can ask another node, and nobody can change that without a huge amount of people noticing. So I don't think this is that big of a deal. I think you just need to go back sufficiently far away so you're sufficiently confident that what you are watching is the real deal, but you don't need to go back to the Genesis block if that gets too expensive. Like there is a trade-off. So another question is, what's the difference between the Merkle tree and the Merkle extreme? So there are two important differences, I'd say. A Merkle tree, you can put the element in it in any order. And because of that, if you want to produce any kind of proof, you need to also produce a position in the tree for that proof. And because of that, you cannot produce proof of absence. You can only prove that something is in the tree, but you cannot prove that something is not in the tree except by producing the whole tree. And so that's kind of a problem. The other major difference is like the Merkle tree can be used as a key value pair and be split by key prefix. So you could not chart the Merkle tree easily, but you can chart the Merkle tree.
Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you, bye.
Take care.